Hello, I think I'm live. Hi, firstly, thanks very much for joining me. Thanks very much for joining this little Mindful Munch community. If you've been hanging around in here for a while, you've probably been maybe waiting for something to happen. We've not been very active to begin with, but hopefully you've noticed over the past week, been up in the ante a little bit, been more recipes and content in there. And I'm planning on going live in here once a week, probably on a Tuesday or maybe actually a Wednesday at about this time, about 8 o'clock. And we do that for the next 4 weeks to share some top tips to help you better plan your meals efficiently and effectively. So by the end of the month or in 4 weeks' time, you're gonna be a meal planning pro. That's the plan. Now, meal planning sounds kind of boring. I know it does. I'm under no illusions. I fought against it for a long time because I want to be this sort of spontaneous, fun-loving, free spirit that whips up a fresh and delicious home-cooked meal whenever I want. But the fact of the matter is that never happens. I wish it did. I hate to be a naysayer, but it just doesn't work. Particularly if you're trying to eat a predominantly plant-based diet, because you do have to be that bit more considered to make sure you're getting all the right nutrients into your diet and stuff. So that's why I think it's actually really important to meal plan. Boring as you might think it is, I think it is important. And having a plan just makes it so much easier to, and I think this is the critical thing, to eat for good health rather than just to eat to exist. And if you don't have a plan, that's kind of what starts happening. You eat to exist. Your quick and easy meals start to look like, you know, pasta, pesto, veggie stir fry, avo and toast, or porridge for lunch because you've only got oats in the house, or porridge for dinner even. Now, do not get me wrong. I love all of those meals and there's nothing wrong with them in isolation. They're all good meals. But you have to sort of think about your meals in isolation, but as well as you know, throughout the whole week, and think about actually, where am I getting my protein from? Am I getting enough protein? Do I feel satiated afterwards, or an hour after eating, are you sort of like have a sugar craving or opening the fridge door and searching the fridge's soul? We've all been there. Or are you getting a good variety of ingredients throughout the week? Or are you eating the same things just on repeat? And are you actually enjoying cooking? Like, that might not be that important to some of you, but that's actually quite important to me, to actually enjoy cooking. And are you exploring new recipes and ingredients to sort of widen your horizon or the variety of nutrients that you're consuming? You know, so those things, they might not actually be things that you think about or things that are necessarily why you're meal planning, but you'll have your own sort of list there that's important to you. And I think the key thing with meal planning is what it allows you to do is be more mindful with what you are eating throughout the week. So you can eat, like I said, for good health rather than just eating to sustain. And whatever that list of things that you are thinking about with your nutrients or your diet or your health, you know, meal planning can help you achieve all of those or at least get a step closer. So I've done quite a lot of thinking and meal planning for myself, for others, and for you guys, recording meal plans and blank sheets of paper staring at me. And actually what I've heard time and time again, and what I sort of come across is actually the main barrier to meal planning is writing that plan. Is that blank piece of paper sort of staring back at you and you're sort of like, oh, I don't really know what to do here. You like the idea of meal planning, but actually, where to start? And the key barriers, I think, that keep showing up are, firstly, a time barrier. It's like just another thing to do on that very, very long to-do list. And, you know, can you not just cook your food? Well, I'm going to crush that one today. We're going to show you how you can create your own meal plan in 15 minutes. And it'll save you hours throughout the week. It really actually will. Like, I know everyone says that, but it really does. Secondly, I think some people don't like to meal plan kind of out of pride or something. It feels like an unnecessary thing, you know, I can cook, I don't need a meal plan. But I think you should actually be really proud that you care enough about your health to take the time to plan. And lastly, which I think is one of the most common ones that I hear, is that it feels restrictive. So it's kind of like a freedom barrier. But that one, I think, you know, eating having a meal plan allows you to, it gives you freedom. It allows you to eat for good health that will give you the life that you kind of want to live. And it'll allow you to have the life that you want to live until you're much older age, because you're not going to be suffering for chronic illnesses and things like that. So not only that, but it will also give you more energy, which will ultimately give you more freedom. And actually, it'll give you more time too, won't it? Well, I mean, time is time, but you can do more in that time if you've got more energy. So, having broken down those barriers, and hopefully now we're all on the same page that meal planning is definitely worthwhile. We were probably on that page before you even showed up tonight, so I hope anyway. Right, so now I'm going to, 15-minute timer starts. I am going to show you how, I'm just setting a timer to make sure that I don't go way off piste, because it's likely. I'm going to show you in 15 minutes how you can create a meal plan for yourself. So, first things first is set your goals. And we kind of forget with a meal plan that it's a plan. And to create an effective plan, you have to set goals. And so what are your goals for your meal plan? Is it to eat more protein? Is it to eat more veg? Is it to eat less sweet things? Is it because you want to get some new recipes into your diet and get a bit more experimental? Sorry, I'm just trying to close a few tabs because my laptop's kind of spazzing out here. Is it because you want to fill the freezer because you know you've got a really hectic week coming up and the following week, and you want to sort of get ahead and get some food in the freezer? Is it because you're trying to feed the family and actually you need to have various different variations to suit all taste buds? Is it because you're trying to get more savoury breakfasts into your diet rather than sweet? Your goal is your goal, and I'm not suggesting it's necessarily any one of those goals, or it has to be any of those, or that it should be more than one. Pick a goal, you know, set your goal and let that be your gold standard for when you're creating this meal plan and something that you keep coming back to. And now what you're going to put in your meal plan will be shaped by that goal. So let's set that out from the start. My goal is to eat savoury breakfasts every day and to make sure all, if not most, of my meals have a good source of protein in them. So what we're going to do before we start thinking about a calendar and days of the week or anything like that, write a list. Breakfasts, dinners, lunches, this is probably back to front, and snacks. Make sure you've got savoury and sweet snacks. And write a list of 2 to 3 recipes under each column. Before you start trying to think about days of the week and all that, just keep it really simple. Now, you might even at this point sort of think, oh, this is a blank sheet of paper and I'm struggling for inspiration. So if that is the case, then have a recipe book, recipe site, have, you know, save things on Instagram as you go. I do know a good plant-based recipe bank if you want to try that one out, shameless plug. But you'll see in the event I've put a link where you can sign up for free, and that unlocks all of the recipes in our meal plan, in our mindful meal planning site that's got loads of different recipes in there, so it's worth a look. But yeah, with your goals in mind, write a list of these different recipes that you could have throughout the week. So for example, for me, I've said, okay, I could have tempeh for breakfast, I could have tempeh bacon, avocado smash on toast, scrambled tofu with veg. For dinners, and I say you do dinners before lunches because I feel like dinners can quite easily feed into lunches. So for dinners, maybe we could have a chili, teriyaki tempeh maybe. I love that meal. A stir fry with crispy tofu. And then for lunches, I always have a soup on there because it's just super easy and easy to prep. So it fits into that sort of saving time need. Always have a sandwich in there because quite often there's a day that you need to go to the office or something like that. So it's good to have something portable. And I generally have a salad in there as well. So let's say it's a hummus and roast veg sandwich and a tofu salad, let's say. And then savory snacks. For savory snacks, I tend to look across at what the recipes I've just done for the breakfast, dinners and lunches are and think if there's anything that you can sort of beg, borrow and steal. So if we've made hummus anyway, maybe some hummus and carrots or some tempeh skewers or avo smash, we're having that for breakfast anyway. And then for sweet treats, I always have either some smoothie bags in the freezer. I tend to make some energy balls, which again, keep really well in the freezer. And I quite like having chia pudding and stuff like that as well. So some of them could be really sort of recipes that you know and love. And actually, I would really recommend that some of them are recipes that you know and love. You don't want to make this meal plan too hard for yourself. So firstly, you only need to write two or three recipes under each column. You don't need five recipes for each day of the week, because that will become overwhelming when it comes to cooking. You can reappropriate some components and you can eat leftovers and stuff like that. So two to three will be absolutely fine. And then we'll sort of work that through into the plan. Cool. And then, so the other thing I would say is don't go through these recipe books and think, and this is really easy to do, and this is what most people do when they write their first meal plan, is go through a recipe book, pick out all the recipes that they really want to try and ram them all into one meal plan, because that is going to get overwhelming too. You're suddenly going to be cooking a week's worth of new recipes and it just becomes really difficult to do. So limit yourself. This bit's actually hard. Limit yourself to one or two new recipes within your meal plan for a week, unless your goal is to experiment with more recipes and then maybe just do two or three. But I wouldn't recommend doing more than four, even if your goal is to explore new recipes, because it will just quickly become overwhelming and it'll become, you know, hassle rather than fun, which is never what you want. All right. So now we've got our list of recipes. Sketch out a grid that's your sort of calendar of what's X and what's Y. X-axis is breakfast, lunch, dinner and snacks, and Y-axis, along the corridor up the stairs, Y-axis is your days of the week, Monday to Friday. Well, you'll notice that I've put this download as a link in the event, so you can download that and just use this very grid if you like, or you can just sketch it out with a pen and paper or on a whiteboard, easy. But you'll notice that I haven't included the weekend in there, because I quite like to keep the weekend free, in case anyone invites me out for dinner. But it's nice to have some flex, and I don't ever want to be in a situation where you're sort of really, really rigid with meal planning. You want to be able to live your life, and you don't want to have to sort of, you know, go out for dinner and then feel guilty that the food you've prepped left in the fridge. Also, I quite like doing a fridge haul at the end of the week and making what one of my customers so lovely terms, gizinte soup, which is basically everything goes into it. I love it. So I quite like doing that at the end of the week and just kind of any leftovers, you know, making it into a soup or something. But I also quite like experimenting with recipes at the weekend as well. So give yourself some time off, give yourself some free time that's not planned, and take the weekends off. I'm doing a typical Monday to Friday here. If your working week's different, you know, maybe you start on a Wednesday, so your day one's a Wednesday, so whatever works for you there. And then whilst you've got this blank grid without any recipes on it, think about your week and what that looks like. And are there any days that you're, for example, you're in the office and you need to take a packed lunch in? Packed lunch is a bit retro, isn't it? But whatever. You need to take something in that's portable. Mark that out and cross that off or mark that as PL or whatever on your grid, and cross out any days that you you're going to be eating out or getting takeaway or something like that as well. So you know what days you're going to be where and what when you don't need something to prep. Cool. Now have a quick think about when you're going to do most of your cooking. I tend to front load my week. And what I mean by that is I do the big prep session at the beginning of the week. So, for example, if I'm prepping Monday to Friday, I'll do the big prep session on Sunday. And that way you can prep lots of the recipes that take a bit of time when you've got a bit longer to cook. So I'll spend a couple of hours cooking on Sunday, which means I can get those recipes that take a bit longer out of the way. And then later on in the week, I can make the quicker, easier recipes that just sort of take half an hour at dinner time. And that kind of works for me in terms of that flow. Of course, if you have Wednesdays off, for example, then you might want to flip that on its head, and that's cool too. So make that work for you. All right. So now we've got our meal plan. First thing, if you go back to your list of breakfast, lunch, dinners, and your list of recipes that you looked at, now look at that and think, okay, which of these recipes are easy to sort of batch up and prep in advance. So I'm looking at mine and I'm thinking, okay, tempeh bacon, that's a good one. You can make that in advance. And also tempeh is a bit of a pain to cook, so that one works. Let's put that on the Sunday prep session. Chili, that one takes a while, doesn't it? It's a big sort of batch pot meal, so let's put that one on the Sunday prep session. Soup, I mean, that's always on my Sunday prep session, so let's get that one in there. Hummus, it's a really good one that you can make in advance and then use it throughout the week. Energy balls, and actually maybe smoothie bags too, you can prep them and just have them in the freezer, so you've got them for as long as you want. It doesn't even need to be eaten within that week. So there we've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Actually, the baked tofu, you could do that in advance as well. 6 things on there that you can prep on your Sunday session and save you time throughout the week. Brilliant. Good start. Are you keeping up? Can't actually see comments. Let me just... Please do hit any put any comments in the questions in the comments as we go. I'm kind of rattling through it because I'm trying to prove to myself that I can do this in 15 minutes. But put any questions in and I'll answer them at the end. So we know what we can batch in advance. We've got our grid. We know when we're eating out. We know when we're going to the office and all the rest of it. Now I'm going to plot those meals that we're going to batch on Sunday in the first couple days of the week, or the first sort of 1 to 3 days of the week, because you want to eat them whilst they're fresh where possible. And then I'm going to fill the last couple days with the other recipes that I wrote down that you know are sort of quick and easy and you can make in the evening just before dinner. So for example, like our teriyaki tempeh and our stir fry with baked tofu. We've already made the tempeh and the baked tofu actually, so they'll be really quick ones to make on like Thursday and Wednesday, Thursday, Friday evenings for dinner. And then like our avo smash, you want to make that fresh. Chia puds, you kind of want to make that fairly fresh as well, so you can plot that further down in the week. Awesome. So with a bit of sort of Jenga-like positioning, you now have a full meal plan, which is populated with, you're not going to be able to see that, but populated with all of your meals that you've written down. Brilliant. However, this never works first time. And don't think yourself as not a meal planning genius when you do this and you're sort of scratching your head and think, but it doesn't work. I can't make it sort of all fit in. It never does, don't worry. That's why you need to do it in pencil or on a whiteboard to begin with. Now what you want to do is actually look across that week and think where it's a bit wacky, where you don't actually want to eat like that. So for example, look across now, not in terms of what are all your breakfasts, what are all your lunches, what are all your dinners, but look across your day and look at, okay, what am I eating on Monday? And actually, if I look at my plan, as I've just said, to do it there, my Monday looks like an awful lot of beans. So I'm having a spicy tomato bean soup followed by for lunch, followed by a chili for dinner, followed by hummus for a snack, or not followed by, but thrown in there. So it's very bean heavy. And then when I look at the bottom half of the week, the latter half of the week, there's a lot of soy in there. I'm having scrambled tofu for breakfast, and then I'm having tofu salad for lunch, and then I'm having stir-fried tofu for dinner. So, and then I'm having tempeh skewers for a snack. So that doesn't work. We need to sort of do a bit of, what's that game? Tetris. To make that feel a bit more varied throughout the week. So how about I swap the tofu salad and the soup for the lunches, and I swap the tempeh and the tofu around, and I swap the hummus and the tempeh around on the snack. So you'll see that there's sort of ways that you can change it around to make that work, to make sure it feels like a day of eating that you want, rather than it all feeling a bit too rigid and samey. Because that's the most important thing, really. You want to look at this meal plan, and it transforms from a meal plan into a menu that you're like, oh, I can't wait until Wednesday. That's when you become a meal plan boss, is when you look at it and you're like, oh yeah, bring it on. So once you're in a place where you're looking at your menu and you're thinking, oh yeah, bring it on, now is the time to create your cooking schedule. Now, I know I'm getting to a point where you might be rolling your eyes at me and saying, do I really need a cooking schedule? But you do really need a cooking schedule. Because what that does is that is what saves you time. So, okay, you've made a plan and you've decided what you're going to eat. But if you just cook all of those meals individually throughout the week, you are actually going to spend an awful lot of time cooking. So you want to create your cooking schedule so that it flows and it makes your life easier. If you don't have that cooking schedule, then what will happen is on your prep session, you'll forget to make something. And then, you know, you'll kind of throw the meal plan out. You'll throw the baby out of the bathwater, or rather the meal plan out of the spinach. So, yeah, you want to make that cooking schedule and it really will help save you time. And that is the most important thing, or that's one of the key things for me when it comes to a meal plan, that it saves you time. So your first prep session, you've kind of already created by thinking about what you can batch cook in advance. So if you go back to that and think, okay, what was I saying was easy to batch in advance? The soup, the chili, the hummus, the tempeh, the energy balls, the baked tofu. Now, if you go back to your menu that you've created and you're looking forward to eating, scan through day one and day two and make sure all of those meals are covered off by what you've written in your easy to batch list. If they are, great. That is now your first prep session that you're going to do on Sunday. If there's anything in there that's not covered within that easy to batch session, list, add it to the list, and that's what you need to cook in your first prep session. Simples. And then that really brings you to, that's kind of taking you halfway through the week. If you do that prep session on Sunday and that covers everything from day one and day two, Monday and Tuesday, you know, you don't really need to do any cooking Monday, Tuesday. Then take a look at your day three and see what is there, and see what you need to prep for day three. So I'm looking, we've got Avo Smash for breakfast. That's fine. You can sort of make that live if you like. We've got hummus sandwich for lunch. That's fine. We've already made our hummus. And so that's fine. We've got that ready to go. And for dinner, it's stir fry with tofu. So, okay. So for dinner, we've got to make our stir fry on dinner on Wednesday. That's cool. So let's look forward. And that's the thing, whenever the key thing with meal planning is when you're cooking, look forward for the next couple of days and see what else can I cook whilst I'm cooking this dinner to help me out for the week, for the days to come. So if I look forward, okay, we've got scrambled tofu for Thursday and Friday. So actually I'm gonna make the scrambled tofu at the same time as I make my stir fry. And then we've got a chia pudding for a snack as well. So I'll make that chia pudding at the same time too. So there you have it, second prep session is on Wednesday evening when you're making your stir fry for dinner. You're also going to make your scrambled tofu and your chia pudding. Done. Now look through the rest of the week. And actually, I'm looking through the rest of the week and the only thing left to cook is the teriyaki tempeh stir fry. We've already made the teriyaki tempeh, so we just need to make the veg to go alongside it. So we'll make that for dinner on Thursday, and then we just need to make sure we make enough so there's leftovers for Friday lunch as well. And there you have it. After just a big prep session on Sunday, a wee prep session on Wednesday evening, and cooking dinner with enough to have leftovers for Friday on Thursday evening, you have prepped your week's worth of food. So the hard part was really writing this plan and the prep session on Sunday when you sort of did that big batch cooking. But I'm a big believer of set aside 2 hours. Never make your prep session more than 2 hours. Otherwise, I think it just becomes quite laborious. But set aside 2 hours, relax into it, get some tunes on. And yeah, it's amazing how much easier you can make the rest of your week flow if you do that prep session on Sunday. And like I said to begin with, how much more mindful you can be with what you're eating. So you know now what you're eating for the week is actually what you want to be eating from a sort of nutritional point of view. You've thought about this, you've set your goals of what you want to eat for the week ahead, you've made a plan, you've executed the plan, you're 100% comfortable with what you're putting into your body for your week. You're not sort of like munching on pasta pesto 3 times a week thinking, this probably isn't the best actually, is it? So totally worthwhile and empowering way to eat. I've gone slightly over, but that's it. So I really hope that that was useful. It was how to meal plan for your week in 18 minutes. So it wasn't too bad. Yeah, I really hope that was useful and not just kind of common sense. I realized that I've been spending quite a lot of time meal planning and creating meal plans over the last year or so. And there's probably, well, hopefully, some useful little nuggets in there that I was keen to share with you. So yeah, hopefully that was useful and not just me sort of rambling at high speed for 18 minutes. Like I say, if you've got, I know there was a few people who said they're going to be watching back. So if you're watching on replay, if you've got any questions, stick them in the comments and I'll reply to them. I'll try to keep an eye and reply to them as soon as I can as well. But if you do have any comments, I'm not sure. If you do have any comments, pop them below and I can answer them. Just drop me a message if there's anything that you'd like to ask. Now, I know that was quite quick and I sped through it, but if you are trying to create your own meal plan, then watch this back, probably pause me at each step, and hopefully it'll be quite a useful guide to sort of keep you on track for the key things that you want to do to create a useful, mindful meal plan. Like most things, it's quite tricky the first few times, but the more you do it, the easier it gets. And if you're sold on the concept of meal planning, but you're not quite ready to dive in and do it yourself, then your little Brucey bonus for tuning into this live session is that I'm going to give you a free trial, a 1 month free trial of our Mindful Meal Planning membership. And in there, there's the plant-based recipe bank that's got loads of amazing, if I do say so myself, amazing plant-based recipes. There's so many in there from shepherd's pie to quinoa salads to smoothies. There's all sorts of stuff in there that's really useful for building your own meal plan. But there's also 4 ready-made meal plans in there that you can just grab and go. It's all in there. It even generates a shopping list for you with quantities and all that sort of stuff. So if you're bought into the concept of meal planning, but all that sounded a little bit much like hard work, then check out the meal planning membership and you can get months free and see if meal planning's for you. And that'll probably give you quite a good feel for what it's all about and finding your flow with meal planning. And then from there, you can feel better equipped to create your own plan. So that's it. I'll wrap it up. Sorry, I've kind of gone over, but thank you so much for tuning in. And come back again next week. I'll let you know what time for another live. And I'm going to talk next week about streamlining your prep sessions. So now you sort of have this sort of, plan in place. How do you make sure those planning sessions go smoothly? There's an art to it, believe me. I'll have your meal planning pros within the month. Right. Thanks very much, guys. Have a wonderful evening and I'll see you soon. Bye.